What's up, guys? It's Sean and welcome to another episode of the iherng podcast. Today, we will answer another question from email. This is from Calvin. Hi, iherng. Hope you are well and keeping safe during these hard times. First and foremost, I want to thank you for taking the time to educate us newbies on property investment, even though you are a very busy man. I watch your podcast on Yum Cha sessions, 24 hours of sleep a week. It's just crazy. I am one of your avid YouTube viewers, so I have watched most of your educational videos aside from some of the property reviews, cause out of budget lah. I actually have a lot of questions for you, but I think it will be too long for your YouTube video. So I will try to keep it short and concise. To give you some context, I am 25 years old, living in PJ, payroll of 5,200 a month, and I have 100,000 in liquid assets. No liabilities and loans, but have credit card which fully paid every month. I am looking for two kinds of property. The first is a homestay property, which I will stay in for the first 3 to 5 years, then later become an investment for rental income, which I hope can have positive cash flow later on. The second kind is purely investment, either for rental or flipping. I understand maybe I will be too broad in my intent of buying, as you would have thought, but I feel as I am still young, I should not lock up too many of my capitals for just a home stay. Below are some of my questions. Number one, given my profile, could you suggest a budget that I should be looking at for properties, both investment and homestay? From online says I should only spend around 30% of my income on installments. Number two, can a primary market purchase be a good investment where the rental is more than the installment, or secondary market and auction market will be easier to find? Number three, in the perspective of investment, what are your thoughts on new service apartments project which are built nearer to new townships, such as Exim project in Damansara, Perdana, KL Metropolis in Mount Kiara? As the discounts of this property below market price outweighs the risk of project failing. My thought of mine is that if there is a risk, the return can be bigger if it was a success. Sorry if the questions are silly and long. Looking forward to your reply, and if it's not too much to ask, if you got space for a young Padawan to learn from you more closely. Best regards, Calvin. So first of all, thank you very much, Calvin, for the long email, and I guess you know that I love context. So just to summarize the entire email again. Young man, 25 years old, living in PJ, every month earning 5,002, have 100,000 in liquid assets, very good. Looking for two types of property, own stay for the first 3 to 5 years, then hoping that it will be rented out for cash flow purposes. Then the first question is, how much should you be spending on a property, especially for own stay lah, okay? So online, his research is 30%. My take on it, Calvin, would be different, because it depends on your ambitions. Like, I'm seriously very impressed with the amount of money that you have. A lot of people say you need to have 100,000 in savings by your 30, but you are way below that, and you are not earning some extravagant income to begin with. Maybe staying with the family helped a bit, but seriously, your profile is amazing. Like, your story, right, can be such an inspirational story for a lot of young people. It's just so good to have that financial awareness when you are at a younger age. That being said, right, I think a lot of professional financial planners will have the rule where 30% for house, don't know, maybe 10-20% for car or traveling, then all these kind of things, right? To me, when I was younger, it was 120%. I would put 200% on investments if I can. I would spend zero on lifestyle elements, zero on entertainment. Then I stayed with my family and I invest the rest in real estate and some stock markets and forex like back then. If you have listened to the 4 hours podcast, you would have some context, right? And that was my game plan. Was it extreme? Yes. Was it right? Now looking back, I will repeat the same way, but just that not to go so bullish on certain things and maybe take 1 or 2 weeks off in the 3 years period so I get to do things only a 24-year-old can do. But I have no regrets. I was constantly hustling and things like that because I have the ambition of being financially free. So I get to do the things that I love very, very much. And I get to say no to the things that I don't like doing. That was my ultimate goal, actually. Nothing too fancy, like a lot of people would have fancy car or a bungalow, a mansion, right? To me, I was not driven by that. I was driven by achievements. I was driven by a whole different series of things. So my answer is no, there's no definite, right? But a safe rule of thumb would be 20 to 30%. I've seen extreme investors still renting a room of his own investment unit, right? Meaning that he has 4 units, but he's living in one small bedroom of his only. The rest, right, he's renting them out. That's why many commented that he has no taste in life, don't know how to enjoy life, stupid. But when you look into his rental income, he's laughing the way to the bank every single month. Number two, the difference between primary market, secondary and auction. Which one can find a deals that is easier to have cash flow positive? This depends in the network that you have around the market. For a newbie like yourself, I think a sub sale would be a safer bet, where you get all the fixed data, for example, the rental rates, the price per square feet, the condition of the place, the neighbors, the upcoming projects, all those data can be easily found online or on site, and that will somewhat guarantee your returns. Just that the not so good side, you need to pay around 18 to 20% of upfront payment. Then for auction market, again, it depends whether you know the sequencings of procedures. If you know the right agent, they can bring you into the unit. If you don't know the right agent, they will just show you pictures. And if the agent is not telling you the whole story, then it might be a little bit trouble. Then for new projects, it then depends on which level are you. Like I discussed this on some Clubhouse conversations. It's like a pyramid, right? So a normal layman that walks into a sales gallery today, right, they will be paying market price, right? Whatever the developer is asking for. No choice, you cannot nego. So, hey, give me more discount lah, please lah, not pasar malam lah, right? So it's very hard to lobby for a better price. That's why a lot of people rush in for first phase or first launch or the first 10 units, 20 units, right? These are usually the price where the developer is using to test market. So see whether can these people take the bait or not. Therefore, the price would be the lowest, right? Then gradually the price will increase. So then how to get more discounts? Unless you're a business associate, right? You're a consultant that works with a developer, or you have some relatives, family and friends of people working in the development office, then you might get extra discount here and there. The next level on the pyramid would be VIPs, like Tan Sri Ge, royalties Ge. So like myself, I fall under business associate to I hope one day can go to the VIP level, but who knows, right? Then at the tippy top of the entire pyramid, who gets the best price out of the primary market, right, would be bulk purchasers, unfortunately. Because ultimately, development is a business and the properties are stock. So there's no point holding stock very long. And if you hold too long, you cannot sell, then cash flow might be a problem. Then property overhang, all this bad media coverage on them will form certain pressure on the development team. So an easy way out is to just clear these units to bulk purchasers. And these bulk purchasers, right, are they wrong? No, again, it's a business. They will then buy up maybe 100 units, 200 units in one go. Therefore, the price will be cheaper. But then there's just a lot of negative vibe to all these bulk purchasers lah. One of the video I introduced Far Capital, as I'm the client for that company, right? So they also do a lot of bulk purchasing. Therefore, I find better deals. So I'm trying to say, right, it depends on which category you are, and that based on network, that will affect the price that you get. And the unfortunate truth about property is, it's not transparent. You will never know what price I buy. Like my friend just got to me and I realized that we bought the exact same property. But just because I buy via different channels, I'm getting 30% below the price that he's buying. Do I feel bad as a capitalist? No. But do I feel bad as a friend? Very. Third of all, what about new service apartments that are built around master plan projects? Are they easier to fail and things like that? Well, with the current state of governance by our government, right, the housing department is actually very strict. Banks are also very strict because during the previous economy crisis, a lot of projects has been abandoned and we have learned from all those lessons. Therefore, it's very difficult to become a developer nowadays. You really need to be cash rich, and that kind of guarantees the project from not failing, right? Like you now look into the market, right? Those who failed and really failed miserably, they still get people to join venture and to resolve. Not like last time, they will just be abandoned for a very, very long time. And my hypothesis is in the future, developers are like rare Pokemon today. It's very difficult to find, just because in order to qualify as a developer today, it's very, very difficult. Not only you need land, you need a lot of money, a lot of expertise, and if the number of developers keeps reducing, the markets will soon be dominated. And I think there was a coverage on this on the media where like 70% of the market is dominated by like top 10 developers only. That's crazy. These 10 companies kind of like swing the market, whether you want to go up or down. That's scary. So in conclusion, Kelvin, let's just go through the whole spiel again, right? I think the budget for lodging is entirely up to your ambition. Are you a person who wants to win everything in life, or you want to leave it a more moderate one where you kind of just follow the budget, like 20%, 20-30%, I think it's a good amount for lodging budget, for own stay spending budget lah. Especially when you have such cash backup already. I think you understand how personal financing work already. So I guess that would be a good number for you. But again, it depends on the lifestyle that you want. It's okay, I think, to enjoy a little bit if you can afford. But if you think that you are young, you can still go through greed, save a little bit more to enjoy finer things in life later. Entirely up to you, right? And the second point will be the entry level. Like, which level are you in this pyramid of purchases? Are you that normal Tom, Dick and Harry, or your family and friend category, or the business associates category, or the VIP category, or the bulk purchasing category? So a big factor that determines the success level of your investment, right? A lot of people don't talk about this, is the entry price. Like if you go to sub-sales, it depends on how you negotiate. If you go into auction market, it depends on how much you know insiders, or how strong is your agent in bidding, or does he have inside news? Again, just like primary market, it depends on who you are, where you're from. I guess it's very unfortunate and it's very realistic in certain ways. I guess that's how the market operates in Malaysia. And last of all, it's very rare for developers to build halfway and jow already, right? And I think the success rate depends whether you're a public listed company versus a Sendrian Berhad company, right? I think we have discussed this before in one of the vlogs. You can go find it out. And I guess that's all for today, Kelvin. Thank you very much for the email. And for those who still have questions regarding real estate, do just email me at tanihereng@gmail.com, or you can just DM me on Instagram, iherng. And I'll see you on the next one. Waiting, okay, ciao.